Good morning and welcome to St. James Episcopal Church. Glad to have you with us. We are glad to welcome back Father Rick Kautz to celebrate Holy Eucharist with us this morning. Also, we are using the right one liturgy throughout Lent. So just beware that some of our responses might be a little bit different. For example, instead of "and also with you," we say "and with thy spirit." I'm excited today to welcome back choir and congregational singing. I know there's not a whole lot of us here today, but few can be mighty, as our choir has proven. So most of us may give up something for Lent, but I've decided to take on something for Lent. I hope that you can indulge me in this. And that is, I'm going to be introducing the hymns with a little brief commentary, just to offer you, the congregation, a deeper and more meaningful worship experience through song. I hope today's familiar selections will encourage you to dust off those vocal cords and sing heartily. We sing together as one voice, not a room of individuals. So no matter how timid you may feel, I hope you'll set aside your inhibitions and add your voice to the glorious sound. If your neighbor sounds rusty, just give them a little grace. And if you feel a little rusty, give yourself a little grace too. We are all in this together. So our first hymn today is 690, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah." Lent can feel like a pilgrimage through barren land. The pandemic has kind of felt that way too, don't you think? So this hymn is actually a prayer for direction, healing, and courage, things we all may need at any time. As a reminder, it's customary to stand to sing as soon as the organ introduction begins.
Thank you. Bless the Lord who forgiveth all our sins. His mercy endureth forever. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan. Make speed to help thy servants who are assaulted by manifold temptations. And as thou knowest their several infirmities, let each one find thee mighty to save. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. When you have come into the land that your Lord, the Lord your God, is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house." The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Paul's letter to the Romans. The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. After his baptism, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him and showed him an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, from the Lord your God, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The Gospel of the Lord. The words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be always acceptable in thy sight, my Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Amen. Alrighty, we're getting to the good stuff of Lent now. Temptation. And temptation, of course, leads to sin. Temptation and sin. I was driving somewhere in Louisville, and there was those churches who have signs out that they can change periodically. And the sign said, "When temptation knocks." All right, no, actually that doesn't make any sense. "When temptation calls, hang up." That's easy. When temptation calls, hang up. You got the wrong number, hang it up. We like to externalize temptation and personalize it and give it body and form, anthropologically make it seem real to us. Temptation is that little devil on your shoulder that tells you to do bad things. And of course, you want to listen to the little angel on this shoulder that tells you to ignore the little devil on that shoulder. Have you seen that old cartoon, the little red devil with horns, poking you, do this, do that, sin? We also like to think of the devil out there on the street corner. offering whatever vice it is that will lead us into sin and temptation, whether it's alcohol or loose women or gambling. Hey, buddy, come over here. I got something to show you. And we're lured and we're tempted, because all temptation is from out there. And oh, we hate to say this, but we really do love the devil. Because we can blame the devil for a lot of things. I look around this room, and most of you probably remember the 70s, Laugh-In and Flip Wilson. The devil made me do it. That's so nice for us. Not my fault. I couldn't help it. The devil did it. Can't resist the devil. The devil is powerful and mighty. Don't blame me. Not my fault. But temptation doesn't necessarily come from outside. Now, there's external temptations for sure. My temptation is when I go to the grocery store to stay away from the bakery department. Because there is not a donut that's created that doesn't know my name. And I get anywhere near a donut shop or Dunkin' Donuts or the bakery department, and all I can hear is, we're so delicious. Of course they're delicious, but they give me heartburn and ruin my diet. That's temptation. Now, if I had a donut, would that be sin? Probably not. But that's sort of how we look at temptation. Those things that kind of tempt us to lead us astray, there's always something out there. A temptation comes in many forms, and in many ways, as varied as there are people and as varied as there are sin. But I want to just bring out a few things. One is to remind us what sin is. Sin is not an act. Drinking, smoking, all those things may not be healthy, may not be good for you, but those acts in themselves are not sinful. What sin is a break in relationship. Sin is not about doing bad things. It's about hurting people, yourself and others, and your relationship with God. So when I am in sin, I am estranged from God. And when that does, it makes me estranged from other people. If I care more about the bottle or the donut than I do people, then that's the sin. That's the sin. So now, I'm sure you're all good Episcopalians, and you know that we do the general confession on Sundays, except optional during Easter time. And I'm sure you also know, because you're very versed in the Book of Common Prayer, that there is the sacrament of penance in the prayer book. Episcopalians have confession. And it is recommended that at least twice a year, during this penitential seasons of Advent and Lent, to partake in private confession. Particularly on the days of Good Friday or Ash Wednesday are set aside as holy days when one goes to the priest for private confession. Now, when you have gone to confession, I know that sometimes it's hard to remember all your sins, especially if maybe it's been a while. And so the priest will encourage you to write them down when you come in. And so you go down and you sit down and you sit down with a piece of paper prior to your confession and you start thinking, okay, what sins have I done since my last confession? And you probably will bring up the Ten Commandments. Well, I've honored my mother and father. No, I haven't killed anyone. I haven't, made false testimony for anyone. And you think, well, I'm doing pretty good. I'm doing pretty good. I don't really have much to confess. Maybe I can skip this Lent. Forget that part. See what happens over the summer. I might need to confess something coming back. But I have a little book here that I love. I got my book when I went off to seminary. It's an Episcopal prayer book, St. Augustine's prayer book. Very small, fits in your wallet, your pocket or your purse. I got it when I went off to seminary. You can get it at Forward Movement, which is out of Cincinnati. It's also on Amazon. It's even on Kindle. You can get it on Kindle. And they have all sorts of prayers in here, but they also have what my favorite part is, and the Sacrament of Penance, much longer and more involved than the one we have in our Book of Common Prayer. But they also have, in prior to that, a little explanation and the self-examination. This is what you sit down with when you write out your sins and say, oh, what did I do? And it breaks them down in very, the graph. I love graphs. I just, you know, you give me a flow chart, you give me a graph, and I'm in heaven. And it breaks them down according to the seven deadly sins. We all know right there at the top of the list is pride. And then we get to anger, envy, covetousness, gluttony, and sloth. Then in that chapter, then under that, it goes to subsections. Subsection A. Under pride is irreverence, sentimentality, presumption, distrust, disobedience. Then under that, it lists all the sins that fall under that category. So I think, oh, I'm a very humble person. I don't have the sin of pride. Well, let me see down here. Pride, subsection, irreverence, article A. Neglect of worship of God every Sunday in his church. Or being content with a perfunctory participation in it. Disregard of other holy days of additional opportunities for giving God honor. Failure to thank God or show gratitude adequately. Sentimentality falls into the sin of pride. Being satisfied with pious feelings on beautiful ceremonies without striving to obey God's commandments. I don't like that one. Distrust, sin of pride. Worry, anxiety, misgivings, perfectionism. Oh, that's pride? Yep, it is. Oh, I can just go on. We could take all day to do this, but we're not going to do that. Let's go to sloth. You're very industrious. I'm very industrious. I don't sit well. I don't vacation well. I'm always doing something. But under sloth, subsection 2, indifference. Unconcerned over injustice to others, especially that caused by currently accepted social standards. Or unmindfulness of the suffering of the world. Oh, failure to become adequately informed on both sides of contemporary issues? You mean I have to understand where you're coming from? If I just listen to CNBC or Fox News, whatever side of that aisle you're on, I have to understand the other side, because if I don't, that's sloth, and sloth is one of the seven deadly sins. There's a movie in 1967, one of my favorite movies, called Bedazzled. They remade it in the 2000s somewhere there. Near good. 1967, British, Dudley Moore and Peter Cook, great English comedians. Peter Cook is Satan, and he's coming down to tempt Dudley Moore with the seven temptations. And of course, lust is played by Raquel Welch. And they're walking along, and Satan is dressed as a traffic cop, and he's just going along making all the meters expire and giving everybody tickets. Because that's what Satan has nothing better to do. He's doing that. And Dudley Moore says, so what is heaven like? He says, because you were an angel once. He says, oh yes, I was Lucifer, the most beautiful of the angels. I was God's favorite angel. Well, if heaven is so wonderful and you were God's favorite, why did you get kicked out of heaven? And so he hops up on a British mailbox. And he tells Dudley Moore, okay, I want you to dance around me and tell me how wonderful I am. What? Yes, worship me, adore me, tell me I'm beautiful, I'm handsome, I'm wonderful, tell me how, just adore me, dance around and adore me. So Dudley Moore dances around and says all these things. And he stops and he's kind of exhausted. And it's Satan says, the devil says, so what do you think? He said, well, I would like to change places. And Satan goes, that's exactly what got me kicked out of heaven. You see, God's on the throne, and everybody adores him, and he is adorable. But I wanted someone to adore me, just a seraphim or a cherubim or two. you know, to run around and love me and tell me how adorable I am. And God got so angry and called to the sin of pride and threw me out of heaven. And all I wanted was to be loved. All I wanted was to be loved. When we sin, whether it's addiction or not addiction, whenever we sin, we're in an odd way trying to love ourselves because we feel a vacuum. We feel unlovable or unloved. We feel that something's missing. And so people do terrible things in order to make themselves feel better. You know what sin is about, really? We don't sin. You know what sin causes. But it makes us feel better for the moment. I had a friend who is no longer in ministry, a parish priest, who fell badly, very badly. Ruined his career, ruined everything. And I look at him and go, why would you do that? I mean, you're a priest, you know what you should be doing. He's one of the greatest preachers. He's a great preacher. His church was growing. And he just messed it all up. Why? Why did you do that? He said, well, she threw herself at me, and I figured I work hard, I deserve it. Oh. No, didn't it ever occur in this conversation? No, I deserve it. Something was missing, and he thought that that would fill that. An overworked, tired priest with four children at home, and it was easier to find that fulfillment outside the lines in a way that cost him everything. I preached a whole sermon once on the movie Hannibal, which is a sequel to Silence of the Lambs. And one of the parts of that film was someone who survived one of Hannibal's atrocities. What he literally did was he peeled his face off and fed it to the dog. What could be worse than actually doing that? And the detective, Starling, said, why would you do something like that? What would possess you? And all he could say was, it seemed like a good idea at the time. Temptation doesn't come from somebody on the street corner with a trench coat, you know, with a packet of watches, or a bottle, you know, here, drink this, eat this. Temptation comes from inside when we are empty and frightened and alone, and we look to fill that with the wrong stuff. And it seems like, at the time, it's a good idea. I'm standing in the donut aisle of Kroger. It seems like a good idea to get that donut. But it's not. But it's not. So when you think about sin, other people's and our own, maybe it will help us to cut other people a little bit of slack. Try to understand where their pain is, where they're coming from. That, yes, maybe they were born evil, but that's a whole theological question. Are we born evil or are we born good and we fall? Sometimes when you see somebody else fall, you can realize, I can cut them some slack or maybe understand where they're coming from. It also then helps with you to understand where you're coming from, to resist temptation. It comes not, you know, the obvious places from outside, but it comes from that loneliness inside. And what Jesus tells us is the only thing that can fit that hole is not the stuff you put into your body, but it's the Spirit of God. To know that you are beloved of God. hesitation because you're afraid of getting smacked upside the head, or struck by a thunderbolt, or sent to spend eternity in damnation. You know that the best way to discipline children is not by threatening them, but by loving them into a better place. And that's what God is doing with us. God isn't here to smack us or smite us. God is here to love us. And that's the good news of our epistle today. No matter what you do, it's not about what you do, it's about what you have in your heart. As long as you can say yes to God, you are saved. That's that piece of nugget of good news in all of those readings today. For me, it doesn't matter what you do, the things are not important, the acts are not important. What is important is love. And when you sin, you hurt yourself and other people, and you hurt God. To be open to let God love you and let Him fill that void. And that gives you the power to resist those inner voices that say, well, it seems like a good idea at the time. It's the best idea. It's just trust God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us stand, if we are able, to affirm our faith at the Nicene Creed, page 326. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, the eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified, has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially for Michael, our presiding bishop, Terry, our bishop, Mary, our deacon, and our visiting clergy, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. In the Anglican Communion, we pray for the Anglican Church of Korea. In the Diocese of Kentucky, we pray for St. Paul's Church, Hickman, and racial healing. In the parish cycle of prayer, we pray for the generosity of our congregation as they donate monthly food bags to the American Red Cross food bank in Buckner. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially for Joe, our president, and Andy, our governor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. We pray for all victims of violence and those who perpetuate violence. Let your peace extend to every person, that all may live as your beloved children. We also remember before thy throne of grace our enemies and our armed forces, especially for those on active duty. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, the rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. We rejoice in God's blessing of life for those celebrating anniversaries and birthdays, especially for those we name either silently or aloud. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We pray for those on the parish prayer list, those who have received our healing blankets, and for those we name, either silently or aloud. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, and those we name, either silently or aloud. Beseeching thee to grant all of them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of James and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Let us pray for the Rector Search Committee. Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously on St. James Church, and so guide the minds of those who shall choose a rector for this parish, that we may receive a faithful pastor who will care for your people and equip us for our ministries.
You who do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all evil, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy have promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto you. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. Blessings for our food and for the blessings. For God and Heavenly Father, I ask your blessing upon this food that not only may nourish the bodies of those who shall receive it, but nourish their spirit as well. Be with the ministry that support them and sustains them, and bless the hands that have provided it. Now the prayer for our healing blankets. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God. God clothes me with the garments of salvation. The Lord covers me with the robe of righteousness. O God, whose blessed Son has sanctified and restored creation, send your spirit and blessing upon these blankets, that they may be an outward and visible sign of your presence and love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May our prayers and these healing blankets be a comfort to those in need, bringing hope to the frightened, peace to the anxious, healing to the incurred, strength to the weak, and joy to the sorrowful. May our prayers and these blankets of joy bring delight to your children, that those who are wrapped in them feel your heavenly assurance through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns now. Walk in love as Christ loves us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
So today for our offertory, we're going to all participate. One of the great traditions from Africa is spiritual song. Another interesting tradition is learning music without notation by root. Many of you already know this tune, possibly, but we're going to sing it today without a printed score, with the choir's help. So, peace, joy, and love are themes appropriate for any time of the year, and yes, we can experience joy in Lent. The basic text for this little spiritual song is in your service booklet. So, the choir will sing verse 1, Peace Like a River, once, and then we'll ask you to join us on I've Got Peace Like a River, and then the other two verses that follow.
I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river.
Thanksgiving, page 333 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was in every way tempted as we are, yet did not sin, by whose grace we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer unto ourselves, but unto him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and singing. Oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue the perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make clear before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer to thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make. Having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks, for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer to thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden in service, not laying our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, grant us thy peace. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercy. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed upon him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.